So today I am delighted and honored to introduce today's guest, Professor Pieter Abbeel from UC Berkeley. Now, Pieter, as you may know, is one of the leading experts in the field of artificial intelligence. He is the recipient of many awards and prizes, and one of which you may have heard about last year was the 2021 ACM Prize in Computing for contributions to deep reinforcement learning for robotics. And he is also the director of the world-famous Berkeley Robot Learning Lab and co-director of the equally famous Berkeley Artificial Intelligence Lab. He's also a serial entrepreneur and currently co-founder and chief scientist at Covariant AI, a robotics AI company. And also, last but not least, host of the very popular Robot Brains podcast. Pieter, welcome to the show.
Hi, Seamus. Thanks so much for having me.
I got to say, that is quite the resume. So let's get into this. So as I just mentioned, you're director of the Berkeley Robot Learning Lab and co-director of the Artificial Intelligence Research Lab over there. So please, first and foremost, tell us about your research there.
Yeah, so my research is, I would say, generally in artificial intelligence, and it's something I've been excited about for a very long time. I remember at the end of my undergraduate studies, trying to think really hard, and this is back in the late 90s, so a long time ago. What is the most exciting thing I want to do for the rest of my life? What do I want to specialize on? And I remember thinking there's just nothing more exciting than trying to understand how human intelligence works. But then it also occurred to me that it's very hard to understand human intelligence. It's very hard to measure anything in the brain, and it was not clear how much progress was really possible. And then I thought, well, you know, what if we try to build intelligence, you know, approach it from an engineering perspective? Wouldn't that give us a lot of insights and also allow us to build systems that can be really helpful in many, many ways? And so ever since then, essentially, I've been pursuing AI research, and I'm still equally excited, if anything, even more excited these days, because it's proving useful now. When I started, it was just the academic interest, but now there's so many applications, which is really exciting.
No, that's fantastic. And we want to get into more advanced topics later, but for our audience unfamiliar with deep reinforcement learning, can you give us the, I would say the 5-minute interview, but try and keep this short, maybe the 3-minute overview?
Sure. Yeah. Within AI, there's, of course, many, many areas of research. And my own research has been largely in deep reinforcement learning. And maybe the easiest way to explain reinforcement learning is by first explaining supervised learning. So in supervised learning, the way you build an intelligent system is by giving examples. So, for example, you might give an image and say what's in the image, a cat. Give another image, say what's in the image, maybe a dog, and keep giving examples. And then you would train a typically very large neural network to learn to internalize the pattern based on what you see. What should you say is in the image? And so this is directly learning from examples, and it can work really well if you can collect enough examples for the pattern you want your AI system to internalize. But now reinforcement learning is a little different and has always been a bit more exciting to me, because in reinforcement learning, you're actually not required to give examples. The idea in reinforcement learning is that you just specify the goal your AI is supposed to achieve. For example, maybe in a video game, maximize the score in the game. Or maybe for a robot, let's say run as fast as possible. Or maybe do a flip, or maybe pick and place items in a warehouse like we do at Covariant. And so in reinforcement learning, you just specify what you want, and then the agent is supposed to figure out from its own experimentation what's the best way to achieve this. And this has two really interesting benefits. One benefit, just probably obvious from the way I teed it up, is that it's simpler from a human perspective. You don't have to exhaustively give examples. You just provide a specification, and then the system learns on its own. Of course, it's a more complicated system that's required to do this, but it's simple as a human to specify what's required. Another really interesting benefit is that it can actually exceed human capabilities, because you could specify something, some score, some metric that'll then optimize, and it might find a way to achieve a higher performance than you as a human could demonstrate, show it. And so it allows it to effectively discover new things in the direction that you want it to try to discover new things.
Yeah, it's such an incredibly powerful technique. And I would encourage our audience now or later to check out Pieter's research page. You'll see some amazing videos there and some great insights. Now, Pieter, you're doing a virtual workshop on deep reinforcement learning at ODSC West beginning of November. Can you give us a few quick details on the agenda of that workshop?
Of course. So when you look at deep reinforcement learning, it's actually, even though it's nice, as I described, in that you just specify what you want and then the agent is supposed to figure out how to achieve it on its own, the algorithms that power the agent are actually a bit more complex than, let's say, a supervised learning approach. And so we're going to cover a wide range of algorithms actually in reinforcement learning. It's interesting. In reinforcement learning, there's no single approach that is the, like, this is what you use. Compare that to supervised learning. You say, okay, you set up a neural net architecture, you run backpropagation, gradient descent, stochastic gradient descent, and at the end of the day, your model has been trained. In reinforcement learning, there's a lot more complexity for the agent, and it's also not fully converged. So we're going to cover a range of approaches. So when we think about reinforcement learning, there's kind of two big categories of approaches. One category is model-based reinforcement learning. And the idea there is that the agent doesn't just learn from its trial and error in the world, but also builds an internal model of the world from that trial and error, and then simulates how things go in that model. And so there's additional learning happening in a learned simulator, which can often make it a lot more efficient in terms of the amount of real-world interaction that's required, because a lot of the learning of the agent happens in the simulator it's building on its own from its experiences. So that's one of the two main categories. We'll look at that in great detail. We'll also look at model-free approaches. In model-free approaches, the data the agent collects through its trial and error is used to directly improve a policy or a Q function, which are essentially the underlying constructs the agent uses to make its decisions the next time it gets to do an experiment in the world. And so we'll look at both of these and the foundations of what's under them. And then from even within those, there are different methods because it's not a converged field. So I'll show you the nuances of why people might prefer different methods in different situations. It can depend on how expensive it is to collect data in the environment. It can depend on how expensive to simulate. It can depend on how large the neural network that's being trained and so forth. So we'll look at those nuances. And then from there, once you've seen the foundations, we'll also look at a couple of the very important aspects of getting reinforcement learning to work for real-world applications. So when you think about reinforcement learning in the purest sense in some way, you think of this agent that just starts from scratch and figures it out. But for many real-world problems, and even for academic research problems like simulated robotic problems sometimes, or games and so forth, it's actually sometimes very hard for the agent to learn from scratch. And so often we need other things to make the agent more efficient. And so we'll look at those ideas, like what does it mean to set up a curriculum where the agent goes through a sequence of tasks, just like, you know, humans. You don't necessarily learn to run right away. You might first learn to crawl and then to run, or maybe then walk and then run. And then later only you learn to jump, and the progression goes on. Same with reinforcement learning agents. Often it makes sense to set up curriculums. Another thing that often makes sense is that even though I've told you in the kind of pure form, reinforcement learning is so simple. You just say, this is the score I want to optimize. This is what I want. And now just do it. Like maybe I want a great meal served on my dinner table tonight. And now agent, go optimize this, right? But actually the agent has no clue how to do that unless you have given it a bit more guidance, right? Same with a baby who's born. You're not going to tell the baby, I want you to, you know, help me clean the house or help me do this or that or solve this math problem. it's a gradual process. And along the way, you give encouragement for other things that are maybe not your end goal. For example, if you think about a cooking robot, you might first give it encouragement about just moving its arm around in a way that becomes more predictable. Then you might give it encouragement for picking up objects reliably, placing them reliably, stirring things. And so you build up over time. And so there's other scores you bring in. And this is called reward shaping, where you, as a practitioner, shape the reward to make things work much faster than if you would just try to get the system to learn on its own with no guidance. So we'll look at some of these things. We'll also look at some of the, I'll highlight some of the recent, very recent research progress in reinforcement learning, where a lot of it these days is in unsupervised reinforcement learning. And sometimes merging two fields that are both very popular, but then it's happening in a single agent. And the way to think of that, just at a high level, and it's actually where right now a lot of the research in my own lab is at Berkeley, is can we make agents play? Just like children would play. And when you think about play, what's the fundamental concept of play? It's that you actually don't have to prescribe what the task is. It's the idea is that the agent should just on its own do a wide range of interesting things, and in the process, hopefully acquire interesting skills. So maybe a humanoid robot, when asked to play, would learn to crawl, would learn to get up, would learn to run, would maybe learn to open doors, pick up objects, and so forth. Just because that's a way to keep itself entertained. And so getting that to emerge in AI systems rather than just humans, humans, of course, naturally have this, is a really very hot research topic right now with a lot of progress. And so we'll look at that quite a bit. We'll look at some other research topics. Yeah, and then, of course, we'll have time for questions and so forth.
Peter, those are some great topics you've outlined, and I look forward to that workshop. I'm sure many other people are. Now, you did your PhD dissertation at Stanford on apprenticeship learning for reinforcement learning with applications to robotic control. And you saw the potential of reinforcement learning early. So let me ask you a two-part question. When did you come to the realization of the importance of reinforcement learning? One, and two, have your expectations of reinforcement learning and what it can do evolve since your PhD dissertation?
Yeah, those are great questions. So it's kind of interesting to think about now because it's almost 20 years later, right? And looking back, I think right now it's kind of hard to imagine this was the case, but actually when I started my PhD, if you went to a robotics conference, there would be no machine learning people. If you went to a machine learning conference, there would be no robotics people. They were two completely separate fields. I mean, that's crazy because how could you have robots doing truly meaningful things in the world if they can't learn from their own experiences, from examples, and so forth? But that's how it was at the time. And my PhD thesis was one of the first to really investigate how to bring these things together. Like, what are some of the things that will open up first if we bring together learning and what was used in robotics at the time were traditional control methods? And so actually one of the things we did at the time, this was together with my PhD advisor, Andrew Ng, of course, we went around and we asked controls people, what's the hardest control problem, one that controls still has trouble with? This is our thinking was, then maybe that's a place where learning can help. Because obviously, if controls solve it, there's no point in doing learning. You want to solve new problems that are unsolved by bringing in learning. And they said helicopter control is a very hard problem. It's a naturally unstable dynamical system. So if you don't continuously give very precise feedback control, helicopter is going to drop out of the sky. Yet, expert human pilots can extremely reliably control helicopters, fly them at very high precision, do acrobatic maneuvers with the remotely controlled ones. And so it was a big gap there between human capabilities and visual controls capabilities for helicopter flight. And so we thought, well, that's going to be our challenge, right? If we want to prove that learning can bring something to the table and in robotics, that's a natural starting point for us. And so at the time, our thinking wasn't necessarily specialized to reinforce learning per se, but generally what kind of learning can help here. And we did something that's, I would say, still very common today. The way we approach the problem is by a combination of imitation learning and reinforcement learning. So ultimately what we did is we said, if we collect enough demonstrations from a human pilot flying the helicopter and record all the data of that, then we can do effectively supervised learning to learn the pattern in the human piloting, as well as the pattern in the dynamics that that's encountered during those flights. And then once we've learned that, on top of that, if we just use that, it's probably not going to work because it only understands exactly what the human was doing. And that one of the challenges with imitation learning, of course, is that if you just do imitation learning, you usually are a little bit different from the demonstrator. And then when you deviate it just a little bit, all of a sudden you're in uncharted territory, so to say, and what you learn might not be as applicable, and you haven't learned how to steer back on. And that's effectively where the reinforcement learning then comes in. So you start with imitation, learning a model of how the human and the dynamics are. From there, you then try to do it. It will not necessarily succeed right away, but reinforcement learning can fine-tune it. And I'll say that's been a recurring pattern actually for me since. This notion that reinforcement learning is really the way to get the full level of performance that you want. A few years later at Berkeley, we had a project on robots organizing laundry, something I think a lot of people wouldn't mind having help with. And we had done very careful combination of traditional robotics methods with effectively what we can think of as imitation methods. But it would still sometimes not succeed. And it seemed like we would have to keep giving demonstrations or otherwise hard code exceptions to exceptions to exceptions forever. And it just seemed like the natural solution was once you reach a certain level of performance, the robot has a general sense of what to do. Let the robot run on its own and let the robot on its own run reinforcement learning to keep fine tuning its skill. And that's again, also what we actually in the real world applications we do at Covariant now, we see the same thing. We can teach robots many, many things to be super productive in warehouses. And then to get it to the yet another level, we can have the robots also do reinforcement learning to keep improving their skill on top of what they learned from the data that we provided them. And so to me, that's kind of a recurring theme, especially when you think about the practical application of reinforcement learning. It is hard, very hard to learn from scratch. It takes a long time, but if you provide data that has demonstrations in it, you start there and then fine tune the performance with RL, you can get to levels that are much, much higher than you could get to otherwise.
Excellent insights, Pieter. And to be honest, if I had to choose between a laundry robot and AGI, I think I'd pick the laundry robot for sure, especially in a Sunday afternoon. And speaking of successes, I guess a fun question here. So what have been some of the biggest successes of deep reinforcement learning to date in your mind? Like, I know there's a lot of examples out there, but from your perspective.
Yeah, I think essentially the first major success that put deep reinforcement learning on the map, though it wasn't called deep reinforcement learning at the time, was the backgammon results. Garrett, Tesauro, TD Gammon if you look back at it, it's essentially roughly the same methodology that we use today. Of course, the devil's in the details and it's not exactly the same methodology and so forth. But in broad strokes, the ideas were there like many, many decades ago. And so this led to a world-class backgammon player, AI backgammon player. So that's of course the big early one. Then I think what we saw is we saw a period where, as I think most people listening in know, where neural nets kind of weren't so popular. And it's then around 2012, with, of course, the AlexNet moment, Jeff Hinton and his students for image recognition, that neural nets were fully brought back into what everybody's thinking about, because it was such a major breakthrough. It was clear this was the way to go, actually, even though it had been abandoned by most people for a long time. And to me, that was also the time that I really got re-excited about the potential of reinforcement learning, because that's when the modern wave of deep reinforcement learning started, actually, right? And if you look at the history, you'll see it actually happened kind of in parallel with work happening at DeepMind and her work happening in my lab at Berkeley, with, of course, my students and postdocs like John Shulman, Sergey Levin, Chelsea Finn, Rocky Duan, and so forth. And for me, the reason it was so exciting to see that ImageNet result is because when we look at the specifics of reinforcement learning, we look at the algorithms, I think we had a reasonable understanding of the algorithms, but somehow the information wasn't absorbed from the data the agent was collecting. And it's really that switch using deep neural networks as the underlying fabric, because deep neural nets are essentially data sponges. And the more data you give them, they absorb the patterns and, you know, give more data, just make your network larger as needed, and more patterns get absorbed into the network. And it's really that switch at the time that we made both at Berkeley and at DeepMind to start using deep neural nets with reinforcement learning that started a whole new impetus in the field. And so I think, you know, the big early results that remained very exciting today to me was DeepMind had the Atari results, where they showed that an agent can, from its own trial and error, learn to play a wide range of Atari games. DeepMind had the AlphaGo results, where agent learns to play the game of Go, which many people had projected would take decades before computers can beat the best human players. But all of a sudden, this methodology exceeded human performance by the best, world's best human player by quite a bit. And then in parallel at Berkeley, we're really thinking about the robotic side of things. Can robots learn to control themselves through deep reinforced learning? And we saw great signs of success there with both simulated robots learning to run, as well as some real robots in the lab learning to manipulate objects. And I think those results between the games at DeepMind and the simulated and real robots at Berkeley, to me, was build a lot of confidence that there's so much potential here, not just for me. I think a lot of people got very excited. If I think about some major results since then, I think robotics remains a place where a lot of breakthroughs have been happening with deep reinforcement learning. Same for games. Think about those two fields in robotics. A lot of real-world legged locomotion now is done with reinforcement learning, some of the most impressive results. That's a big change, because 10 years ago, that was all hard-coded Boston Dynamics, like magic wizardry, and then a YouTube video pops up, but you don't know what happened under the hood. Now, reinforcement learning can consistently do those kind of things, too. We see games like StarCraft, Dota, where, you know, really high-level performance is achieved. But I think one of the most, maybe, initially to me at least, surprising things is that it's also beyond games and robotics. If you look at science, for example, and engineering, for example, circuit design, reinforcement learning agents can help with circuit design. We've done some of that work at Berkeley, there's been work at Google, at other places, showing that an agent can learn to design circuits and find new designs. So it's very, very exciting to see that. I've seen it applied in optimizing HVAC building control to minimize costs there. I've seen it applied in optimization of control of chemical plants to optimize the yields and minimize the cost there. And so it's been very interesting to see, in some sense, anywhere where you are trying to optimize some metric over time, it's like it's a sequence of decisions you have to make to optimize that metric. We're starting to see that indeed deep reinforcement learning, which is meant to address those problems, of course, it's the whole point of deep RLs to address those problems, but it's also really starting to happen. which has been really fun and exciting to see.
Yeah, absolutely. Many more breakthroughs ahead, and that's going to be exciting to watch, and including your research as well, Pieter. Now, just one thing you mentioned previously, I'd like to dive into a little deeper. So reinforcement learning agents, you know, they can use a variety of machine learning algorithms and methods. And you talked a little bit already about why deep neural networks are a favorite technique, which I'd love you to expand on that a little bit. And then, you know, at ODSC, we're always covering different kinds of neural networks. And so when you think about doing deep reinforcement learning, why, what are the different neural networks you should consider when building that?
Right. So, I mean, that's a big question. No matter what kind of deep learning you're doing, whether it's deep reinforced learning, deep supervised learning, deep unsupervised learning, deep self-supervised learning, I think the neural net architecture is really key. And an example I like to think of from real life is, of course, it's always more complicated than just one aspect, but if, let's say you have a baby and you have a dog and you talk to them the same way, right? At the end of the day, the baby will turn out to, let's say, speak English fluently, typically, understand what you're talking about. The dog will learn about 5 to 10 words, right? And so you got to think, okay, well, maybe it's something in the hardware of the dog's ears. It's possible. It's possible. But it's probably also something in how the brain is architected. It's probably also something in how the dog can pronounce things themselves and hence get a feedback loop that way and so forth. There's a lot of factors at play. We got to think that part of it is the architecture, but the dog brain is not architected the same way as a human brain. And so same is, of course, true in deep reinforced learning agents. If your agent has a poor architecture, it's not going to be able to figure out the pattern in the data. And so when you look at kind of the typical architectures used in reinforcement learning today are actually under the hood not too different from the typical architectures used for supervised learning or self-supervised learning. So there's strong similarities. And I think the reason that's the case is largely because the data modalities are similar. Let's say you're doing image processing, whether it's supervised learning or reinforcement learning, effectively, your neural net has to do something very similar. It has to understand what's in the image, make sense of it, and then make some decision based on that. In supervised learning, the way you train the neural net is just with a lot more explicit signal. So the signal-to-noise ratio is much better in supervised learning. In reinforcement learning, you have these long trajectories, and somehow you have to tease apart the signal from the noise. So the learning signal is not as, you know, readily available in reinforcement learning, but it's still the same kind of signal has to be extracted. And so that's why I think there is very strong parallels between architectures in supervised and reinforcement learning. And so the architectures we see are essentially, if it's image inputs, it's convolutional neural networks or vision transformers taking in the input, possibly followed by multi-layer perceptron at the end to turn it into a specific action or a set of actions that you might need at all the joints of the robot. So strong parallels there. Another strong parallel actually that we see is that pre-training is becoming very successful in reinforcement learning too. So when you imagine a vision-based robot, you could think, oh, I'm just going to train it with reinforcement learning, but the signal is weak relative to, you know, other signals you might be able to get. What if you pre-train on a self-supervised task? You will pre-train a very strong vision system that now can be fine-tuned a lot more quickly. And this is a wide range of papers in the last year or two, including from my own lab, that shows that this self-supervised pre-training or simultaneous self-supervised learning with the reinforcement learning can be really, really effective to be more efficient. Now, I kind of jumped in the direction of robotic vision-based agents, but also in other areas where RL is applied, let's say circuit design, we see parallels in architectures with supervised learning. For example, there you'd use a graph neural network, which is essentially a sparse transformer network being used, which is very similar again. So Is it the right thing? I don't know. Should reinforced learning have maybe architectures that are a bit more specialized? Maybe not. It's not obvious to me, because a lot of it also is determined by the data you're trying to process. And what's often different in the RL is the way we process the collected data to turn it into a loss function to try to tease out the signal.
Very interesting and pretty fascinating. So I guess another follow-up question from that would be, so when should one use reinforcement learning? And, you know, looking at that, what are the strengths? And the opposite question, when should it not be used?
Right. I think the default almost typically should be, let's see if we can do it without reinforcement learning. And the reason I'm saying that is because reinforcement learning is still harder to get to work than, let's say, supervised learning. And so if you have a supervised learning approach to the problem, that's probably the way to go. In the end, the reinforcement learning agent goes from some sensory input to an action output. Supervised learning can also go from a sensory input to an action output. Differences in supervised learning, which then would be imitation learning in this context, you're imitating behaviors, you need examples. And so the question becomes, for the problem I'm trying to solve, how easy or hard to collect examples of the behaviors I want? If I can collect a ton of examples very easily, let's start with imitation / supervised learning, see where it lands. Maybe you'll then want to fine-tune with reinforcement learning once the agent has mostly acquired the gist of the behaviors that are desired, but you wouldn't start from reinforcement learning. But sometimes maybe it's very hard to get demonstrations, in which case you might have to do reinforcement learning from scratch. Imagine, for example, you want a robot to do a backflip. It's maybe not so clear how to demonstrate that. Even if you know how to do a backflip, it might be difficult to somehow translate your own backflip to motor join commands for the robot. And so maybe you just right away start with reinforcement learning. Could be similar with, let's say, robot running. Since robots don't have the exact same morphology as humans, you don't know what the torque commands should be. So you don't have direct supervision. And so whenever it's hard to provide direct supervision, but you can still specify the goal. You say fast forward progress while being upright. That's very simple to specify. You put that in code, center of gravity high enough and, you know, forward velocity. Those are the reward components, and maybe minimize torques to not expend too much energy. And that's exactly what people tend to use, something like that. And then the robot can learn on its own. So I'd say, yeah, always default to see if you somehow can at least bootstrap from imitation learning or maybe get there all the way, and then use reinforcement learning from there to get the next level of performance. And in fact, the most famous example for reinforcement learning is AlphaGo, and was done exactly that way. AlphaGo, even though it's talked about as reinforcement learning, mostly when it's talked about, it was actually imitation learning, supervised learning from human expert games. That was how it was bootstrapped. Then it was followed by reinforcement learning to go beyond the human game level, right?
Some great insights there, Pieter. And speaking of, you know, you've mentioned a number of times about collecting examples and how important that is for reinforcement learning. And at OESC, all of our conferences this year, we have a new focus area, new track around machine learning safety, which is a pretty hot topic over the last few years in the research community. So, and again, especially in the field of, you know, self-driving cars, robotics, I know it's kind of like an obvious question, but how important are, say, safe reinforcement learning and adversarial examples in building reinforcement learning to avoid undesirable states? Because, you know, you're trying to get good examples, now adversarial examples.
Yeah, it's interesting, right? Because there's a natural tension here. Because when you think about reinforcement learning, you think about an agent who is exploring the world, trying out new things they've never tried before, right? That's how they can improve their performance. And so there are some approaches to deal with this. So one direction I've been pretty excited about for a while is this notion that what if your agent either implicitly or explicitly has a model of the world that they're learning in the process, and they can use that model to reason through when they try something new or start trying something new that they don't know exactly what the outcome is going to be, will they be able to recover from that, right? So can you imagine, for example, if a robot is standing up and like lifts one toe, let's say, just a little bit, they'd be like, yeah, I can put that toe right back down and I'm still standing up, so I'm good, right? But if I violently swing a leg around, then I don't really know what the outcome's going to be unless I've done that many times before. And only then will I know what the outcome is and decide how to do that right. And so this notion of gradually trying things out that you know you can recover from, and then from doing that, you expand what you know about the world, you expand your expertise, and what next time is gradually trying something out is actually one step further than where you've been before, right? And so you keep expanding your frontier, but gradually, I think, is one direction that's quite fruitful here. I will say at the same time, if you think about the question of safety, it pops up in many, many forms. This is just me thinking about it in the context of when an agent is exploring, but you could also think about safety in situations where the agent is not fully in control. And self-driving is an example, right? Agent is not fully in control. A lot is happening around the agent and very unexpected things could happen. And in fact, the same is true in warehouse robotics. The items the robot encounters are different all the time, always changes the packaging, the way they're presented and so forth. There's always new things you run into. And it's not that the agent can essentially, you know, a self-driving agent can gradually try out what to do when all of a sudden something unexpected happens. And so that's where I think things get very tricky is that, and this is why, for example, I think self-driving is something where we don't see, even though a lot of progress has been made and great capabilities have been achieved, we don't really see it yet the way we imagine it'll be here in the future, because the long tail of unexpected things for which somehow humans are still more robust, right? Humans somehow with something very unexpected have an ability to still react to it. And so that's something that's also of strong interest to me is like, how can we get to that? How can we get to this better, deeper understanding of the world is maybe the way to think of it. And so in fact, a lot of the research in my lab recently has been on video prediction. So video prediction is the problem of if you give the first few frames of a video sequence, can the neural network complete the remainder of that sequence? Now, sometimes it might not mean a deterministic completion. Can it provide multiple possible completions because there is multiple possible completions for that scenario? Not alone in this, of course, for example, Jan LeCun has been talking about this for a very long time. But I believe that if we can do really reliable video prediction, we can build a much more general understanding of the world into our agents. And maybe that could form the foundation of a more robust agent that can be a lot safer when something that used to feel unexpected, out of bounds, long tail, it might not feel that way anymore because the neural net understands so much about the world through, let's say, training on all the YouTube videos that are there, all other videos that are available, maybe, you know, cameras a robot carries around and so forth, many robots collecting data. So I think that's a direction that is very, very promising. And that I'm personally very excited about trying to push this kind of generalization naturally emerging and hence more robustness naturally emerging thanks to very large scale training on video.
So speaking about generalization, do you think techniques like multi-agent reinforcement learning and meta-learning will lead to AGI, artificial general intelligence, which is always the big question everyone's asking?
It's definitely the big question. How do we get to AGI is probably the most open-ended question in some sense in terms of the range of answers we're seeing and also nobody can really know. It's just hypotheses right now. We won't know till we're actually there. So AGI, of course, is the idea that we have an intelligence that is so general that, I mean, people define it in different ways, but it's very general that it's not task specific. Some people define it as an intelligence so general that you can, you know, bring it to any job that exists in the world, and within a day it can start doing the job, let's say. That would be one example of saying this is, you know, AGI has kind of been achieved. Back to the direction that you were hypothesizing, Seamus, about multi-agent learning leading to AGI. I think one way to think of it is, actually, just two angles to that. One angle is why you might believe that, and I think it's not unreasonable, and I wouldn't bet against it, but I don't know if it's necessarily the only way or the way it's going to happen. We have a natural example, right? The one natural example of AGI is humans. It's not artificial. It's, I guess, non-artificial AGI. And that's, you know, humans live in a big population. They have collaboration, they have competition, and those dynamics lead to all kinds of intelligent constructs being built into our society, right? So that's an example. Another way to possibly conclude that multi-agent is the way to go, and that's been one that has been really interesting to me, is that if you think about AGI, you're saying, I want an agent that can solve any task, no matter what task they're presented with. They need to be able either to solve it directly or within a short amount of additional time, figure out how to solve it, right? And the way we know how to get AI to do things these days is train on a very large data set or a set of experiences, and then it's going to have internalized a pattern. And so the counterpart of that for AGI would then be train on a very large number of tasks. So you have an agent who can complete a very large number of tasks, and then hopefully they can complete other tasks easily too. Or maybe if you want to go one level up with meta learning, train an agent to be fast at learning to do tasks, such that when presented with a new task, they're also fast to learn to do the new task. Excellent. The bottleneck very quickly becomes, where do I get all these tasks? And I think that's indeed where multi-agent systems could play a big role. Because once you have multiple agents that compete, that get to collaborate, when you compete, the bar always gets raised. Look at any kind of sport. Today's best athletes in any given sport tend to be better than the ones 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. Because they build upon how they saw previous generations of athletes train, maintain their health, invent new ways of approaching the game, and so forth. And so the bar always goes up and it becomes harder and harder. And the same is true in science. We build on previous science. We understand the previous science to get to the next level. Same in engineering. Same in our everyday lives. Think just about things like cooking. You know, the quality of cooking goes up through our lives because we learn from other people's experiences and so forth. So I think there is something to it that if we want a very wide range of tasks, in principle, infinite, by having agents compete with each other, we can somehow automatically generate this wide range of tasks. And so I do think there's something there that maybe that can lead to AGI. The tricky thing, I think, is how to make sure that the tasks these agents generate for each other are actually interesting. At least in a lot of research we've done and have seen, it's easy for agents that effectively do play in a group where they compete to go off and do very uninteresting things. And so somehow put some boundaries on that to guide it in the right direction is still a pretty open problem.
Pieter, I want to talk about your other interests, your startup, your venture fund, and your podcast, but super quick audience question. How to get started in deep reinforcement learning, and what are some of your favorite open source tools and frameworks doing it?
Yeah, so, well... One way to get started is as part of ODSC this fall, I'm doing a tutorial on the foundations of deep reinforcement learning, a couple hour tutorial. We're going to dive into the very foundations, the math, the algorithmic ideas, and so forth. Beyond that, it turns out the Berkeley deep reinforcement learning course is available online for anybody to watch the lectures, to go through the materials. So that's, of course, a whole semester worth of materials. That's more than 2 hours. Very, very well done by my colleague, Sergey Levin. And then in terms of code bases out there, there's actually a lot of code bases out there, and that's kind of what makes it tricky. But maybe some natural starting points could be stable baselines and RLlib. I've seen those be quite popular recently. And if you're more in kind of tutorial mode, where it's less about using, more about learning, then there's also the spinning up code base from OpenAI, which is a tutorial interleaved with their code base.
Yeah, I've used the OpenAI tutorial. That's a lot of fun. So, Pieter, so in addition to all your research and everything else going on, you're also a co-founder and chief scientist at Covariant. And in addition to that, you've got your own venture fund now, AIX Venture. So, yeah, tell us a little bit about both of those companies.
Yeah. So at Covariant, we started Covariant about 5 years ago. We're building the next generation of robotic automation. And what that means is AI-powered robotic automation. That is what the next generation will consist of. And from the beginning, it was clear to us that if you look at the robots in the world 10 years ago, they're all doing pre-programmed things. And now that's starting to change. We've gotten to a point where we can deploy robots that are trained with learning, that through learning can do skills that otherwise are not achievable and that are actually being really helpful in warehouses doing all kinds of pick and place operations. And so the reason we're focused on warehousing is because when we did the market research, when we started Covariant, we saw that that's a place that sees very fast growth due to the growth of e-commerce, increasing the number of touch points required on each item. Very high demand for more automation to be able to handle, process all the orders people make at the speed that people expect and so forth. And so we saw that there was such tremendous demand and opportunity there. And even when we scoped out the opportunity, kind of a rough back of the envelope calculation says that even if all we do with Covariant is address the market of hands, what people do with hands in warehouses, that's a $100 billion market a year. So it's a very large market in itself. Though I believe our technology is much more widely applicable from a commercialization motion point of view. We're really focused on automating pick and place operations in warehouses of all types. Now to the other things you asked about, Seamus. A lot going on besides Berkeley and Covariant, which are definitely my two main commitments for the past many years now. Also recently started a venture fund, AIX Ventures. And the reason I started is because essentially I was exchanging notes with a good friend of mine, Richard Soker, one of the leading natural language processing researchers, one of the first to do deep learning for NLP. And we were doing angel investing, helping founders as advisors and investors. And we realized that, you know, if we want to do this at a bit larger scale, making a fund would make a lot of sense. And then it wasn't just the two of us. I mean, we talked with a bunch of other people, and there's a total of seven or eight of us now that started this fund together about a year ago. And we really focus on very early stage AI companies. Anybody who's listening and they're starting a company and it's early stage, would love to chat and learn more about what you're doing. And yeah, and then the last part of what I'm doing, which is kind of funny because we're in a similar setting now, is actually I'm the host of the Robot Brains podcast, of course. And the interesting thing is the way it came about is because of the pandemic. I was just thinking, you know, what can you even do during this pandemic? You know, everybody's stuck at home. What would be fun to do for me and maybe also entertain other people? And so I tried it first with my students at Berkeley. I invited a few guests just for a live chat and the students loved it. It was like, wow, this is very different from what we usually do. You know, hearing about the story behind the researcher and behind the research ideas and so forth. And so then I was like, well, if my students like it, maybe there's more people who like it. And decided to turn it into a formal podcast where we host many of the leading AI researchers and entrepreneurs.
No, it's absolutely an awesome podcast. And I think you're being too modest, Pieter. Like, if you want to see who's the who's who of in the AI space right now, go check out that webpage. I was looking at a few of them with Fifi Lee and Andrew Kapachian. Yeah, I could spend the next 10 minutes listing off. So incredibly impressive. podcast, and I see your home confinement was very well used and hope to continue. Do you have any guests coming to mind that are coming up soon you'd like to mention?
So we're between seasons right now. We just wrapped up season two. The season finale there was Jeff Hinton, which of course is like the guest I was always, I mean, the top guest on my mind with, you know, making deep learning the thing that everybody's doing in AI with his results with his students in 2012, right? So that was amazing. We even did a two-episode thing with Jeff because we talked for such a long time. We broke it up in two episodes. Looking ahead, we're going to look at similar people. There is leading AI researchers, leading AI entrepreneurs. And we'll start probably recording in November, December, and start releasing in January. So yeah, stay fantastic. Tuned.
Yeah, and everything's available online. So I'd encourage you to check out season one and season two. Pieter, a pleasure as always. Thanks for speaking at ODSC in the past. I think Wes will be your third ODSC conference. Really looking forward to your workshop. And you have been a fantastic guest. So much insight, so much great analogies. Loved it. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Seamus, and thanks everyone for joining.